Good afternoon. On behalf of the Congregation of Holy Cross and the University of Notre Dame, I would like to welcome you all here to this funeral mass for Reverend Theodore M. Hesburgh of the Congregation of Holy Cross, and to thank you for your presence here today. I believe we are ready to begin. Please stand and face the entrance to the church.
Thank you. The grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, Theodore died with Christ and rose with him to new life. Now may he share with him eternal glory. In the day of his baptism, Theodore put on Christ. On the day of his religious profession, he was clothed with the grace to live the evangelical counsels. At the end of time, may Christ clothe him in glory and enfold him in his love. On his baptism, Theodore received the mark of Christ's cross. At his profession of perpetual vows, he received the image of Christ crucified, and he was invited to follow in his footsteps. May he now come to share in the glory of his resurrection. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that the soul of Theodore, your servant and priest, whom you honored with sacred office while he lived in this world, may exult forever in the glorious home of heaven. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples, the web that is woven over all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. On that day, it will be said, "Behold our God, to whom we looked to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
I should walk in the valley of darkness, nor evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me comfort.
Thank you. have prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head you have anointed with oil. My cup is overflowing.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, no one lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why then do you judge? Or why do you look down on your brother or sister? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of God. It is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then, each of us shall give an accounting of himself to God. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. And he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him and say, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you?" And the king will say to them in reply, "Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did for me." Then he will say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill and in prison, and you did not care for me." Then they will answer and say, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs?" He will answer them, "Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me." And these will go off to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
Cardinals, bishops, fellow priests, fellow Holy Cross religious, Notre Dame Board of Trustees, faculty, staff, and students of the University of Notre Dame, the Hesburgh family, and all the friends of Father Hesburgh, my condolences to everyone. I share your grief. We send forth a great friend and a great priest. You know, at Notre Dame, I'm often faced with daunting tasks, but none are more difficult than the one before me. Finding words to do justice to the life of Father Theodore M. Hesburgh, C.S.C. At last night's wake service, Father Malloy gave a beautiful reflection to which is difficult to add. What I want to do today is simply reflect on the various parts of Father Ted's remarkably rich life in the context of this funeral mass. We should begin with what was central to his life. He was a priest and a vowed religious in the Congregation of Holy Cross. For all the momentous events in which he played a role, all the honors he received, Father Ted always said that the most important day of his life
was when he was ordained a priest here in this church on Notre Dame's campus. As a religious, he was vowed to poverty and obedience. He lived in a small, austere room, shared meals and common prayer with the Holy Cross community, and will soon be laid to rest under a simple cross, undistinguishable from the graves of the Holy Cross brethren who lay with him. Father Ted's clear wish was that his funeral and burial would be as far as possible like those of other Holy Cross religious. In remembering Ted's life, we must also, of course, speak about his devotion to and love of the University of Notre Dame, an institution he led for 37 years and which was transformed under his leadership. When he became president, Notre Dame was a good school with just under 5,000 students, a $10 million operating budget, and a $9 million endowment. When he retired, it had just under 10,000 students, a $176 million operating budget, and a $350 million endowment. He oversaw the establishment of a lay and clerical board of trustees and the admission of women as undergraduates. But the most important thing he gave us at Notre Dame was the vision to be a great Catholic research university and the confidence to realize that dream. The success we enjoy today was inspired by the vision Father Ted helped us to believe in. Controversy follows transformative leaders, and it did with Father Ted. In his efforts to make Notre Dame a great university, critics argued, he lessened its commitment to its Catholic mission. In a famous 1967 Land O'Lakes statement, he insisted on academic freedom and institutional autonomy for Catholic universities. And some said Father Ted contributed to tendency to secularization. I must say that in all my conversations with him, Father Ted's abiding concern was with Notre Dame's fidelity to its Catholic mission. Yet he was always convinced that Notre Dame could not serve the church and the world effectively unless it sought genuine scholarly excellence, and this could not be achieved without enjoying appropriate institutional autonomy and academic freedom. In all he did, Father Ted's leadership sought to strengthen Notre Dame as a truly great, truly Catholic university. He succeeded beyond measure. A third part of Father Ted's legacy was his role in addressing the great issues of his day. The arc of Father Ted's life extended through the Great Depression, World War II, post-war years, the civil rights movement, the reforms of the Second Vatican Council, the Vietnam War, campus unrest of the 1960s, the Cold War, and the disillusionment of Watergate. He was shaped by them all and helped shape many. He is justly celebrated as a founding member of the Commission on Civil Rights and as an advocate for civil rights for African Americans in this country. Father Malloy mentioned last night the 1964 photo of Father Ted locked arm in arm with Martin Luther King singing at Soldier Field in Chicago, an image that has become iconic for us here at Notre Dame. King has become for us a revered figure, but in 1964 he was seen by many as a black rabble-rouser from the South. The mayor of Chicago and the bishop's office in Chicago had declined to participate in this rally. The morning of the rally, Father Ted got a call asking him to be there. What time? Was his only question. He immediately got in the car and traveled to Chicago. In the early 1970s, as chairman of the Civil Rights Commission, Father Ted was critical of the government's lack of commitment to civil rights. In 1970, the commission produced a highly critical report, and Father Ted was asked by the administration to postpone its publication until after the midterm elections. He refused and continued to speak out. When he was reelected in 1972, President Nixon asked for the resignation letters from all members of the commission, which they duly submitted. Father Ted's resignation alone was accepted, and his 15 years on the Civil Rights Commission came to an abrupt end. As we look back on these events, with the rise of Martin Luther King in our estimation, and the decline of the Nixon administration after Watergate, we can miss the controversy around Father Ted's actions and the courage it took to do them. For his work on the Civil Rights Commission, he received death threats. "My basic principle," Father Ted said, "is that you don't make decisions because they're easy. You don't make them because they're cheap. You don't make them because they're popular. You make them because they're right." That moral imperative shaped everything Father Ted did in the public realm. He served on President Ford's clemency board, which decided the fates of those convicted of draft-related offenses during the Vietnam era. He chaired the Overseas Development Council, which helped the poor of the developing world. He played a critical role in saving the lives of countless Cambodian refugees after the murderous brutality of the Khmer Rouge regime. He chaired the Select Commission on Immigration and Refugee Policy, which led to important immigration reform. He helped lead efforts to reduce the threat of nuclear weapons in the midst of the Cold War. His work in the public realm was driven by moral concerns about civil and human rights, peace, and serving the needs of the poorest. He was often regarded as the conscience of the bodies on which he served. He was a great American. He was a great citizen of the world. Fourth and finally, in reflecting on Father Ted's life, we must also note the thousands of unheralded acts of kindness to people he encountered. It's well known that Father Ted had an open-door policy for students who wanted to talk to him, and he gave them counsel and encouragement. After a soul-searching conversation with Father Ted, a young undergraduate, David Gauss, decided to travel to Ecuador and spend 2 years as a volunteer in an orphanage and saw that women and children there lacked access to basic medical care. He returned to the States intent on becoming a doctor and returning to Ecuador to provide that care. Father Ted called his friend Epi Lederer, famous author of the Ann Landers column, who at Father Ted's urging helped fund Gauss's medical studies. After completing medical school, David founded the Andean Health and Development Center to serve the needs of the poor in Ecuador. In 2009, when my invitation to President Obama to speak at our commencement caused an uproar, a number of people approached my mother to criticize the decision. She was understandably anxious about her son. Father Ted got wind of that, and without mentioning anything to me, he called my mother to reassure her. My mother has never in her life appreciated a phone call more. She had no more worries after that, and from that day forward, she and Father Ted were fast friends. I can't begin to tell you all the kindnesses he showed me personally. "You are doing a great job," he would say. "Keep it up." But he would say this not when we had announced some success or achieved some milestone. He would say it at the most trying and difficult times. These are just a few of the thousands of acts of kindness that Father Ted quietly and without fanfare,
helped people who needed it. They too are part of his legacy. They are among the reasons why he is not only celebrated, but beloved. How can we sum up the remarkable life of an admired university president, a champion of civil rights, peace, and the poor, a friend of so many, both great and ordinary, and someone who was always generous to those who came to him with any need? How can we draw together the strands of a life that spanned so many years, served in so many realms, and touched so many lives? Father Ted gave us the answer. Often, he was, first and foremost, a priest. That vocation drove him to build a great Catholic university. It gave his work in the public life its moral focus. It shaped the generosity, his generosity, in all his personal interactions. He often spoke of priest as pontifex, which is a Latin term from ancient Rome that survives in the Catholic Church. It translates literally as bridge builder. A priest builds bridges between people to draw them together to serve the common good, and builds a bridge between human beings and God. When he was reflecting on his decision to enter the seminary at a very young age, he said, "I always wanted to be a priest." He said that he saw a priest as standing between God and man with traffic going both ways. And being a priest, he said, would give him a great power to do great good for everyone I meet. Father Ted prayed that on the last day of his life, he would be able to celebrate Mass. At 11 a.m. at Holy Cross House, last Thursday, Father Ted joined the community and con-celebrated Mass. In the evening, he was struggling to breathe and fading. Jim Hesburgh, Ted's younger brother, and his wife Mary were there. Priests and brothers from the community visited to say goodbye. Some staff members who were off duty came in to be with him. He was surrounded by people who loved him. He passed away quietly just before midnight. Today we gather to celebrate the Mass Father Ted so loved and to commend him to God. If we live for the Lord, said St. Paul in today's reading. And if we die for the Lord, so that whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. In life, Ted gave himself to the Lord, and now we commend him to that same Lord. We cannot but believe that the Lord will respond in the words of today's gospel reading, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom." We loved you, Ted. We now commend you to the God whom you served so faithfully. We will miss you. But we know that you now rest in the arms of Notre Dame, Our Lady, who throughout your life gave you strength, sustenance, and guidance. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him.
God, the Almighty Father, raised Christ, his Son, from death. With confidence we pray in his name.
In peace let us pray to the Lord.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, and for all bishops and pastors of the Church, may they always shepherd the flock of Christ with compassion and mercy.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For Christians around the world who suffer for the sake of the gospel, especially at the hands of terrorists, and for those who have been killed for their steadfast faith in Christ.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For our unbaptized sisters and brothers in the order of the elect, may they persevere in their desire to be initiated into the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ at our celebration of Easter.
Let us pray to the Lord, hear our
For all those who work on behalf of civil and human rights, may their efforts help bring about a lessening of racial tensions in our communities, so that all may accept one another as sisters and brothers made in the image and likeness of God.
Let us pray to the Lord,
For this University of Our Lady, which Father Hesburgh faithfully served as president for 35 years, for God's blessings upon its president, Father John Jenkins, its administrators, faculty, staff, students and their parents, trustees, alumni, and benefactors.
Let us pray to the Lord, hear our prayer.
For the religious and staff of Holy Cross House, who cared for the spiritual and medical needs of Father Hesburgh for some 10 years, in appreciation for their dedication and service.
Let us pray to the Lord, hear our prayer.
For Lisa Wang, a senior in the Mendoza School of Business who died yesterday, for her eternal rest and for her family and friends in the Notre Dame community. For the comfort and consolation of all those who mourn at the passing of our brother, Father Ted, especially members of the Hesburgh family, the Holy Cross family, and the Notre Dame family. May they be comforted by the presence of the Holy Spirit and strengthened by the promise of eternal life.
Let us pray to the Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother, Father Ted, who faithfully served the Church as a religious priest of Holy Cross for some 72 years. May he come to share in the banquet feast of heaven together with all the angels and saints.
Let us pray to the Lord. In company with the Holy Mother of God and all the saints without ceasing, let us pray to the Lord.
God, our shelter and our strength, hear the prayers we offer for our departed brother Theodore. Cleanse him of his sins and grant him the fullness of redemption. We ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that through these holy mysteries, Theodore, your servant and priest, may behold with clarity forever what he faithfully ministered here on earth. We ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you gave life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of his saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and all your saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Kevin, our Bishop, the bishops here and cardinals present, all the clergy, and the entire people your Son has gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Theodore, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. For through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
I am the bread of life. You who come to me shall not hunger, and who believe in me shall not thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father beckons, and I will. And if you eat,
of this bread, you shall live forever. You shall live forever. And I will praise you. And I will praise you. And I will praise you on the last day. Unless of the flesh of the Son of Man, and drink of his blood, and drink of his blood, you shall not have life within you, and I will raise you. And I will raise you up, and I will raise you up on the last day. I am the resurrection. I am the life. If you believe in me, even though you die, you shall live forever, and I will
thank you.
Let us pray. Having received the sacrament of salvation, we implore your kindness, O God, for Theodore, your servant and priest, that as you made him a steward of your mysteries on earth, so you may bring him to be nourished by the truth and reality as unveiled in heaven. We ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
I would like to invite Jim Hesburgh to come forward for a few words.
I would like to preface my remarks by Ted's favorite prayer, Come Holy Spirit. I think I might need it before this is over. But anyways, good afternoon. My name is Jim Hesburgh. I'm Father Ted's brother. And I've been asked to represent our parents, Theodore Bernard Vincent Hesburgh, and our mother, Anne Marie Murphy Hesburgh, our deceased sisters, Mary, Betty, and Anne, and our extended family, most of whom are situated here today. We're overwhelmed, really overwhelmed, by this tremendous show of affection for a very special person. St. Thomas once wrote that the measure of a successful Christian life is to know truly what to have faith in, what to have hope in, and what to love. You look at each of these attributes and you have the measure and meaning of Father Ted's life. Today, we celebrate this life. All that we have for so long taken for granted with Ted suddenly comes into focus. And today, we think of the totality of Ted's time here on Earth. Where do you begin with Father Ted? The seeds of his vocation germinated during his high school years in the early 30s at Most Holy Rosary School in Syracuse, New York, our hometown. A young Holy Cross priest by the name of Father Tom Duffy came to Syracuse to speak about the Holy Cross Order, and oh, by the way, a school in northern Indiana that happened to be called the University of Notre Dame. Ted listened intently, and he said he knew right away this would be his calling. He arrived at Notre Dame in 1934, entered the seminary, and studied for the priesthood here, and in Rome, and in Washington, D.C. He was ordained in this basilica in 1943. His greatest desire at that time was to become a Navy chaplain and to serve on an aircraft carrier. His vow of obedience trumped and overrode his desire, and he was directed to commence his studies for a doctorate in theology. He returned to Notre Dame in 1946, taught in the theology department, was appointed executive vice president in 49, and was named president of the university in 1952. He held that responsibility for 35 years. I was in my freshman year here at Notre Dame at the time of his appointment. That gave me some pause, I'll tell you. Notre Dame grew in stature and excellence under the leadership of Ted and his executive vice president, Father Ned Joyce. Ted always stated that this was a team effort, the two of them. I used to say Mr. Inside, Mr. Outside. And together, they succeeded in making this an outstanding educational institution. Ted was a people person, whether that person was someone he met during his travels, a student, a president, or a pope. He had two major focuses throughout his life, his priesthood and his devotion to Notre Dame. Notre Dame prospered under his leadership, and he has left a legacy that we see all around us in this beautiful campus and in the wonderful Notre Dame family throughout the world. This truly is a very special place. In his words, Mediocrity is not how we honor the Blessed Mother. His outreach permeated throughout the world, in addition to his focus on building Notre Dame, become one of the most respected Catholic universities in the world. He became very involved in national and international issues concerning world peace, civil rights, atoms for peace, world hunger, and of course, education. His moral compass always pointed due north. His list of awards and honorary degrees are known to all and too numerous to detail here. He only wanted to serve, and serve he did, with all the energy and all his considerable talent. In every way, he knew how. He was a man for growth rather than decline, a doer in the middle of the action rather than a sideline critic. Ted took his God-given gifts of intelligence, good health, leadership ability, and his pursuit of excellence and brought major change to Notre Dame, to his country, and to the world. He was truly a man of all seasons, but again, first and foremost, he was a Catholic priest. He was very proud of that, and he felt that his vocation was the greatest gift he had gotten in life. Ralph Waldo Emerson said it very well, and in so many ways reflects Ted's life. To win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of young people, to learn the appreciation of honest critics, and endure the betrayal of false friends, which he didn't have too many, to appreciate beauty around you and find the best in others, to leave the world just a little bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition, to know that even one life has breathed easier because you have lived. This is to have succeeded. Ted did change many people's lives for the better, always positive and ready to make things better. To Ted, problems were challenges, and his forte was in finding solutions. His friends were endless, of every religion, every nation, every class, and every profession. The sermon of Ted's life is amazing in summary. His life speaks for itself to all of you here in this church. His faith, his hope, his dedication, and his achievements speak for themselves. Good brothers and good friends are God's special dividends in life. Ted was a wonderful brother, good friend, counselor, and mentor. Our parents and family are most proud of his achievement. Well done, O good and faithful servants. May the angels come and take you to paradise. Eternal rest be granted to his soul. Amen.
Immediately following this funeral mass, you are invited, if you wish, to join the Congregation of Holy Cross and the Hesburgh family in a walking procession to the Holy Cross Community Cemetery for the committal service. It is estimated that the procession will take approximately 30 minutes and the committal service 20 minutes. After the committal service, there will be buses available near the cemetery for those who wish to go to the Morris Inn. And for those who are not planning on going to the cemetery, shuttle buses and vans will be available following this mass. Buses in the Soren Circle, just north of the main building, the Golden Dome, will take guests back to the Morris Inn. Buses in lot A15, behind Stanford Hall, will be going to the Bulla lot. Our funeral mass here in the Basilica concludes with the final commendation, which will be led by the very Reverend Richard V. Warner, Superior of the Congregation of Holy Cross, who joins us from Rome. Please stand.
With faith in Jesus Christ, let us take leave of our brother, Father Ted. His religious life on this earth was a sign of the kingdom which is to come. May our farewell express our love for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day in that kingdom, we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of Mercies, we commend our brother, Father Ted, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon our brother, Father Ted, in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our brother, Father Ted, forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. In peace, let us take our brother, Father Ted, to his place of rest.
In paradisum, de